Hi, welcome to Clearview Church Online. My name is Donovan Reed, and I have the distinct privilege of being the lead pastor here at Clearview Church. We are so excited that you've joined us for our online service. Would you stand on your feet with me, prepare your hearts for worship and a time in the Word, and my prayer for you is that you are empowered by the Word and challenged by the Holy Spirit.
Yeah. our Kingdom Builder series. So if you did not receive a Kingdom Builder's card last week, you can get one from me this week. And real quick, just to kind of run through it, the top part is to update our info. We believe in doing life together, and we can't get you the right information of what's going on in the church, opportunities to serve, places for us to grow, signing up for a small group, and all the different things that we have going on if we don't have correct information. So we want to partner with you and encourage you, because how many know that we're called to do life together? We're called to be the church, his hands and feet, but we're called to do life together. So filling out the top of that is important to have the right information so that we can do life together. The next thing down there is donation amount. Next Sunday will be our year-end big give so that we can do what we can in the Christmas season to be blessing people. And so this Kingdom Builders offering, here's the journey that we've been on. Last week, if you weren't here last week, then you can join us this week, is it's very simple. Pray to God. God, what is it that you want me to give? God, put in my heart a number to give. Expand my faith, right? Two, God, give me the faith to give that amount, right? The year-end give is not simply sitting down and scratching out what you can give. It's saying, God, what is it that you want me to give? And then give me the faith to do it. Because that participation of that exercise will expand your faith and your journey with him. So what is it that you want me to give? Give me the faith to give it. And then step three is just obedience, right? And we're going to talk about obedience here in a minute with Pray, Give, Go. But I want to encourage you, taking the step of obedience, what good is it to say, God, what do you want me to do? Okay, God, give me the faith to do it. But then we don't do it, right? Whether that's talking to someone. How many of you have ever had God just speak to you to talk to somebody?
Yes.
Right? And then you don't do it. Right? God wants to use us and work through us in building his kingdom. And so that's what the donation amount is. And then I'll talk about the monthly missions commitment and I commit to tithing more specifically next week with our service. And so I want to encourage you, if you want to expand your faith this year, partner with what the church is doing through Kingdom Builders and believe in making a kingdom impact in our community. The year-end big give will be next Sunday. All right. Now, what is a Kingdom Builder? Just so we know what a Kingdom Builder is, let's put that slide up. I am a Kingdom Builder. Say, I'm a Kingdom Builder.
I am a Kingdom Builder.
I put God first.
I put God first.
I give God my best.
I give God my best.
And I operate in faith. Simple, biblical, right? I put God first. Seek first the kingdom, and all this shall be added unto me according to his righteousness and glory. That passage follows, don't worry. How many know that we worry a lot as human beings?
Yeah.
But don't worry. And here's how we know that we can take steps of faith without worrying, is we put him first. When I put God first, he takes care of the rest. I give God my best. How many are grateful that God gave up his son to die on a cross for your sin? I'm grateful we don't have to do animal sacrifices anymore, amen? But both the lamb died on a cross and the lion came out of the tomb. And I operate in faith, Hebrews 11:1. Faith is being sure of what I hope for, certain of what I cannot see. Hebrews 11:6, and without faith it is impossible to please God. If I exist for the pleasure of Almighty God and adding value to others, then I operate in faith. So together, let's say it again. I'm a Kingdom Builder.
I'm a Kingdom Builder.
We can do it better. I'm a Kingdom Builder.
I'm a Kingdom Builder.
I put God first.
I put God first.
I give him my best.
I give my best.
And I operate in faith. All right, this week we are going through Missions Sunday. There should be one of these on a seat near you. We're going to get to it halfway through our sermon, but I want you to take these home, put them on your refrigerator. Everybody sees the refrigerator once a day, right? Or your pantry. Put it somewhere. Yeah, some of you are like 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 times a day. No. Here's the thing. There are people, and we're going to talk about it today. There are people who have said yes to leaving the comfort of everything they've known so that the gospel can move forward around the world to the farthest stretches of unreached people groups. And we support several of them, okay? And there's more than what's on this list. These are just a lot of people out of the state of Ohio for the most part. But I want to share with you, put this somewhere that you'll see it every day. And when you see it, just say, God, I pray a blessing over those missionaries. God, I pray. I literally have prayer requests from missionaries to share with you today. Some of them are our missionaries. Some of them are missionaries getting ready to go on the field. But I want to encourage you and empower you. My responsibility as your pastor is not to do it for you, but to empower you to walk out a Christian life. Amen?
Amen.
I know. Amen. But I want to empower you to partner in missions. Why? Because God has great plans for this world. What is his why? So that what? None should perish. We exist for all generations. How many of you guys enjoyed the full band this morning? Come on, can we give God praise for what he's doing in development? One of my favorite things about that was seeing all generations on the stage. Okay? And I won't give up who's the older generation on that one. But let me tell you something. All right? We exist for all generations. Okay? To know and grow with God through relationship with Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. We do that for those who aren't here yet. Can I tell you something? If you are redeemed by Christ, then you have a responsibility to share the gospel with somebody.
There you go.
And so we are a life-giving, spirit-filled church that's living on mission. Here's the beautiful thing about missions. All right, some of you are like, man, I've never heard missions before or anything like that. Let me tell you, God has been on mission since day one.
That's right.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit at creation designed everything. This isn't in my notes. This is a freebie. Since the beginning of the world, when God spoke it into existence and the Holy Spirit hovered over the world and the Son, right? Jesus, in the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God, and in him and through him all things were created. Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Since the beginning, God has been on mission. What has he been on mission for? Community with us. He created Adam, and right there he goes, I'm here for community with my creation.
Right.
And then he saw that it wasn't good for his creation to be alone, so he gave Adam Eve. And he said, we're on mission to be community with each other. And that's really what boils down your and my existence and purpose is community with Almighty God, the Creator, and community with one another so that we can honor God and add value to each other. That's why we exist. We exist so that none should perish, that all of God's creation should know who he is. The title of today's message is simply this: expect great things from God and attempt great things for God. We should be living in a life cycle as Christians that we expect great things from God. Can I tell you something? God, as my Heavenly Father, wants what's best for me.
Right.
Yeah. Therefore, it's not too far off from Scripture that I should expect in Scripture his promises to be yes and amen as I'm living as a child of God. The critical part is that I'm living, surrendered, just like we sang in that song, as a child of God. I shouldn't expect it if I'm living in my old sinful ways to expect the blessing, right? I should expect discipline from the Lord, right? From my Father. My kids, if they're out of line, I get them back into line. I do that not by blessing them, I do it by disciplining them. So I have to understand that I should expect the promises of the Bible that are yes and amen according to his riches and glory when I live fully surrendered unto him.
That's right.
And as I surrender to the Lordship of Christ, his blessings follows my obedience in every area of my life.
That's right.
I got good news. That's the same for you. Let me tell you something. As your pastor, I want to see you succeed at whatever it is God calls you to do, where God calls you to go, who God calls you to be. I want to see you successful because I want to see us successful because I want to see a place where we have no more room because why? People fill the chairs, not bodies, people. People have souls. Souls matter to God.
That's right.
How many of you know somebody who needs Jesus? Every soul matters to God. We, just like God from the very beginning, have been put on mission. When you were designed and put here on the earth, you were put here with a plan and a purpose. And that plan was not to harm you, but to prosper you and to give you hope for a future. You and I, since we were designed in our mother's womb, God knew us. He put us here in this season at this time for such a time as this so that others may hear the good news of the gospel. And let me help you with that. We get overwhelmed with what it means to evangelize. Let me share it with you. Whether you like someone or you don't, evangelism is simply a saying. And here's the thing. Other people's lifestyle and culture does not dictate what the gospel says. The gospel is the gospel. It's the good news. And you can look at anybody in any lifestyle in any culture and say, I've got good news for you. God loves you. And he wants to have a relationship with you. God is not determined by external circumstances and choices of people. And here's the beautiful part. When those people receive that, oh man, God, Creator God, loves me and wants to have a relationship with me, it creates an opportunity to help them see that, now here's the bad news. Now you got to live surrendered. But it's the best news because that's the best life you could possibly live once you experience that. But you've got to die to yourself on a daily basis so that you can live as Christ. But the good news is very simple. So I want to empower you with this. Is as you go out from here, God has transformed your life so that you can transform the world. And it doesn't have to be eloquent. It can be as simple as saying, God loves you and wants to have a relationship with you. Your friends, your neighbors, your coworkers, your co-retirees, God loves you and wants to have a relationship with you. That can stir on any conversation that can point people to Jesus. Remember, it's not your responsibility to save somebody. It's your responsibility to love them. Jesus saves them, the Holy Spirit then empowers them. Amen? And that whole time that you're saying God loves you, wants a relationship with you, the Holy Spirit is empowering you to point people to Jesus. Isaiah 54, 2 through 3 says this, enlarge the place of your tent, stretch your tent curtains wide, do not hold back, lengthen your cords, strengthen your stakes, for you will spread out to the right, to the left. Your descendants will dispossess nations and settle in their desolate cities. This is a sermon for another day, but what I want you to see here is what God says through Isaiah is prepare. How many have ever gone camping before? All right. How many know those camping tents say that they fit a certain amount of people, right? 4 to 6 people. How many know that's a lie? Okay. Camping, 4 to 6 people. That is if they are not me, one. And they have a sleeping bag and they sleep like this, because the picture will show you that literally this is how we fit 4 to 6 people. 4 people this way, 2 people this way. There is no walking room. So if somebody has to get to the bathroom after everybody's in bed, you're in trouble. There's no room for more. Why do I find it important to see this message as we talk about expecting great things from God and attempting great things for God? Is because I believe one of the first steps we need to do is prepare to receive more people. If we don't have the room for them, how can they get in the tent? How many know that there are people in our community that drive by this campus on a daily basis who need Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior?
Right.
We're living lost in a world and don't know it yet because somebody hasn't had the opportunity to say, God loves you and wants to have a relationship with you. And I'll tell you what, you can beat that drum till kingdom come. Okay? And it will change somebody's life. And you never know whose life it's going to change that might go on to change a city, might go on to change a nation. But I promise you, if you're obedient to God and you beat that drum of God loves you and wants to have a relationship with you, what God has done to transform your life will transform their life, because they're going to experience the blood of Jesus and the power of the Holy Spirit. So we have to be prepared, right? Enlarging the place of your tent, stretching out your corners, and don't hold back, lengthening the cords and strengthening them is building a bigger, stronger place before those are there, right? That's like Noah building an ark. Noah built something that hasn't existed for something that hasn't happened yet, right? It expands our faith. Missions is going to expand our faith. It's going to expand our comfort zone. How many know that comfort is the thing that holds you back from growth? Right? Being content is good. Being comfortable is dangerous. Because if I'm comfortable, I don't feel like I need to do more. If I'm comfortable, then it's within my own hands and parameters. I believe God always calls us into discomfort so that more can hear the gospel of Jesus. Today's message is really simple. I'm going to give you the 3 points right up front. Pray, give, go. Everybody say pray.
Pray.
Give.
Give.
Go.
Go.
It's that simple. And we're done. Amen. Go enjoy. No. Pray, give, go. I want to empower you that every single one of us can participate in missions. How many of you know that in this room, we could not, if everybody individually flew to a different country, we would not touch probably a third of what the countries exist in the world. But yet God has called people, raised them up, called them out of the comfort of living here in the United States, and called them to go around the world into countries and cities and nations and tribes and tongues and villages and jungles and places that they had not yet been. Why? To share the gospel. Now here's the thing. We may not get to go like that, but what we can do is partner in prayer. How many of you are able to pray? Isn't it beautiful that it doesn't require somebody to speak to actually pray? God hears your heartbeat, right? Somebody who can't verbally articulate can still pray to Almighty God and Him hear them. So each and every one of us can pray. Say, I can pray.
I can pray.
Matthew 9:35-38 says this: Jesus went through all the towns and villages, teaching in their synagogues, proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and healing every disease and sickness. Isn't that awesome? Because that's kind of what we're called to do as disciples. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. Pray and ask the Lord of the harvest to send out the workers into the field." We pray. Who do we pray? We pray to God.
That's right.
We don't pray to the missionaries. We pray to God for the missionaries. Amen?
Amen.
When we pray to God, he is all-powerful, all-knowing, and present everywhere. So the beautiful thing is, we don't have to physically be there to partner with them in prayer. We can be in our commute. We can be at our refrigerator. We can wake up and be on the nightstand and just say, "Lord, this morning, wherever they're at, God, I pray a blessing over our missionaries, that they would be effective in communicating the gospel." I'll get to some prayer requests of our missionaries in just a minute. But I want to share this with you is we pray to Almighty God. God is all powerful. Let us never forget that there is nothing this side of eternity that he can't change, redeem, or reform. He's all powerful. Supernatural healings can take place. Evil spirits can be driven out. At the name of Jesus. We have missionaries in parts of the world that are sensitive that we can't say publicly. But let me tell you something. Those are people like you and me. However, they have stepped up, answered the call that God has put on their life to take them into places that you and I couldn't fathom. God is all-knowing. How beautiful it is that when you simply pray the prayer, God bless the missionaries. He knows their needs. He knows the desires of their heart. He knows the walls that they're facing. He knows the situations that are happening. He knows everything that's going on. Before we get to pray, give, and go further, I want you to see our missionaries go through a big process in which they get interviewed, they get approved, then they have to raise their funds. Several missionaries are $10,000 to $15,000 a month for their budget because they're not just raising their family budget, but they're also, and it depends on how many kids they have, their budget expands because of cost of living, but then they also need a budget for the ministry things that they do. So when they say, "Yes, we'll go," it's an expansive amount of things that they do before they ever step foot on soil to do what they're called to do. Yet all of that journey is their calling. So as we pray to God who's all-powerful. He's all-knowing. He knows their needs inside and out. We don't need to know their needs to know that God can answer them, right?
Right.
Let that expand our faith. God, I'm believing for you to send more people to come alongside of our missionaries. And that's not just raising people up from the United States. That's raising up people within the national church in their native tongue, in their native language, having a heart for their people, getting saved and radically transformed by the gospel, and then taking the gospel into the city that they were born in. And then God is present everywhere. I pray that God sends our people to unreached people groups so that the gospel can be heard to the four farthest corners of the earth, so that all would have an opportunity to hear and know the good news of Jesus. Here are our prayer requests from our missionaries. Strength of marriage. How many know that when somebody who answers the call, the enemy is going to attack? And when they're married, he's going to attack their marriage. So strength of marriage, fluent in the language to effectively communicate with people in the native language. We don't often think about this process because of how many times, if you've gone on a mission trip or you hear a missionary, sometimes a missionary will greet you in the tongue of which the country that they're in. And we don't think about it because it's like, oh man, they're bilingual. Do you know the work that went into them becoming bilingual? A lot. Okay? A lot of work goes into that. So even them, the context, the dialect, in different countries, different words mean different things. You could be up there thinking that you're blessing somebody in their language and you're cussing them. Right? I've seen it. I've heard it. Haven't done it. Thank you, Jesus. Maintaining the right heart throughout the missionary process. Just like things wear and tear on you in your job, in your field, and the things that you do, they're human. They're not superhuman. God is supernatural. Christ is supernatural. The empowerment of the Holy Spirit is supernatural. But they're human. They have struggles too. For God to send more workers to the field, sound theology and teaching, boldness of the Holy Spirit, good health. Pray for good soil and conviction of sin. Pray for their families. Open Doors, National Church Partners, Mental, Emotional, Physical Health of Missionary Kids. How many know that, like, my kids, when they were born, didn't, like, sign a deal with God that they'd be PKs? Missionary kids didn't really get the option of, all right, we're here, checkbox, missionary kid. Put it on my driver's license. Yes. But here's the thing. God has called them just like he's called their parents. He didn't make a mistake by putting them on the field. But you know what? They are going to struggle too. Because the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy everything that God has come to build here on this earth through the souls and lives to reach more people than ever before. Encouragement for workers to keep going. Spiritual health of churches. Meaningful relationships in their communities. Wisdom and provision to meet the physical needs of their field. Humble hearts. Live with integrity. Success of our mission of making disciples. Spiritual and physical protection. And the ability to pivot as the world changes. How many know that the world has changed a lot in the last couple of years?
Yeah.
Okay. Some of our missionaries that we'll read on this list, some of them went to countries to reach a people group, and in the process of Russia invading Ukraine, now are dealing with how do we reach the refugees in our community? How do we create a safe space for them to encounter God? How do we, right? It's the same way everybody in the world had to pivot. Some of our missionaries had to come off of the field because of the dangers during the pandemic and have been eagerly awaiting. You want to talk about being displaced from your home? They were displaced from the country in which God had birthed in their heart to reach with the gospel. They had to leave people that they never knew that they would ever see again. We felt it here, but I can only imagine how our missionaries who were removed from their countries and lost their visas during the time of the pandemic, for the people that they've cared for and shepherded and reached and developed and discipled. Now, thank God for technology. They had the ability to do some things, but still, thousands of miles between them, no end in sight. Praise report, we had a couple of missionaries this week who, I didn't even think about this first service, we had a couple of missionaries this week who just got their visas to get back into their countries.
Thank the Lord.
Praise God. Those people need the ability to pivot as the world changes. These are the prayer requests from missionaries around the world in different countries and different cultures. We support missionaries from cities to jungles to mountaintops to South America, North America, Latin America, Africa, Europe, Eurasia, all the way around, any inhabitable place, there's a missionary sharing the gospel. The beautiful thing for you and I is to answer the call to pray. Prayer changes everything. Prayer can shift the needs of missionaries around the world. It can shift the needs in your life. Because we pray to Almighty God who holds the hand in his world, right? He holds the world in his hand. Give. Everybody say give.
Give.
I can give. Matthew 9, 35-38, it says, then he said to the disciples, the harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. One of our prayers needs to be that God would raise up missionaries from within national churches here in the United States and calls them to partner with our missionaries or calls them into new missions fields so that they can share the gospel to people groups, start orphanages, build churches, develop schools, and go on a journey with people so that the gospel can be shared with cultures and communities that haven't heard it yet and effectively reach them with the good news, just like we get to celebrate and worship every day.
Right.
And so here's the thing, though. If we don't give, they don't go. If our missionaries haven't met their budget, they don't get to go onto the field. Right now, I know of several missionaries right here in Cleveland. One in particular is a family with young children who are called to plant churches in France and in Paris, and they are getting ready to go. But if they didn't raise their funding, guess what? They don't go. And then churches aren't being planted. Those churches that God has called them to plant don't get planted. We need to partner in prayer, but we can partner in giving. To give you a picture, as a church, we support most of our missionaries about $50 a month. So they are partnered with lots of different churches and the Assemblies of God and other churches. But I want to encourage you, as you sit here and you look at your Kingdom Builders card and go, man, how can I partner with missions above my tithe? I just want to share with you that if you want to sponsor a missionary that we support, $50 covers a missionary. Here's the thing. Our dream is that this grows and grows and grows. Why? So that none should perish. So that the world could hear the gospel. They can't go if we don't give. Here's the beautiful thing. I want to give you a breakdown of responsibility. Their responsibility as missionaries is to answer the call and go. They uproot their families. They package everything up. They box up their belongings. They put things into storage for years at a time. And they get ready to go into a country that God has called them to, into a place where they're trying to build relationships, open doors, and share the gospel. The way that they fulfill that call is through obedience, and they go where God has called them to go. I am grateful for missionaries. One of the hardest things for me as a pastor is having some of my best friends be missionaries because I know that I can't go down the street to have coffee with them. But one of the greatest things for me as a pastor is having some of my best friends be missionaries because I get to cheer them on, champion them on, and pray and support them as they share the gospel in a place where I can't be. God's responsibility is to provide the resource to send them. God fulfills that resource through you and me, the church, the body of believers. Our responsibility is to send and support. We send and support through our obedience and faith of giving to missions. You and I together, we can pray, we can give. Right? I've got a dream that 1 year will be a church, Clearview Church will be a church, in 1 year that gives $1 million to missions. And that sounds absolutely crazy, doesn't it? But faith sounds crazy till it happens. And then it's reality. We expand our faith by simply saying, God, how can you use me? Here I am, send me. Here's my availability. Do what you can with it. I don't think God wants to have you go bankrupt or into debt in order to send missionaries. But I believe that every single one of us has an ability to pray and give. If you look at the Kingdom Builders card, it's simple. We even gave it broke down, 10, 25, 50, 100, or other. And other could be, you know what, Pastor, I can do $5, or I can do $1 a month. You know, that's fine. Start somewhere, but let's sow a seed into the mission field. Let's see lives change with the gospel so that our missionaries don't have to worry about their finances because they're fully funded, ready to go to reach the world. Here's our missionaries. If you have your paper, you can grab it and read along. Our missionaries, BGMC supports missions, missionaries to children locally, nationally, and globally. Boys and Girls Missionary Challenge are supported by our children's ministry so that they can invest into kids' ministries around the world. Speed the Light provides transportation for missionaries. When Pastor Frankie and Pastor Sarah went to Costa Rica this past, was it the summer? Fall, September? Preparing for our trip next September, they went and they got to ride in their Speed the Light vehicle. And how many of you know that going up hard roads with rainy season and potential for mudslides requires a 4x4 vehicle?
Yeah.
How many of you know 4x4 vehicles aren't cheap? So Speed the Light sponsors vehicles so that missionaries can get to where they need to get to serve the people they need to serve that God is going to reach with his gospel. Dan Klein is our missionary in Nicaragua, Bill Schrader, Peru, Mike Hattinger, Costa Rica, Jonathan Wellborn, Argentina, Jay Rostifer, Madagascar, Eric Musart to the Ukraine, Rick Bettiger to Germany, Tyrone Silva, Northern Pacific Rim Nations, David Turner, Guatemala, Jesse Cook, Chi Alpha, Indiana University. So Chi Alphas are people who've said, yes, I will reach and shepherd public college students with the gospel and create a way that they can be connected to the gospel after they leave their churches and their parents' house and get to make adult decisions and help them make adult decisions for Jesus, right? Paul Burkhart is Chi Alpha, Alaska. Randy Young, Agora School of Ministry right here in Cleveland. Timothy Strange, Costa Rica. Christine Little, Zambia. Chris Bowser, Peru. Robert Spector, Rock of Israel, reaching Jewish people through the gospel. Joseph Weser, Chi Alpha, Youngstown State. Jim Loker, Audio Bible, Mexico. Jamie Silva, Thailand. Wycliffe Bible Translators Global. Richard McCartney, Wales. Jim Thacker, Africa. Nicole Sheffy, Chi Alpha, Kent State. David Fane, Church Planting. They are church planters in a sensitive part of the world that we can't share with you, but just know to pray over the success of their church planting and reaching people. Ryan Jordan, he and his wife Caitlin were here this past year, missionaries to Colombia, starting 10 campus ministries across the country of Colombia. Ohio Church Multiplication Network, church plants in the state of Ohio, Network Ministries, operations of our state office and Heartland Conference Retreat Center, life transformation through camps, retreats, and conferences. Now, here's what I want to share with you, some fun things through our participation with Ohio Ministry Network, church multiplication, as well as the Conference and Retreat Center, as those are not missionary boots on the ground, but what they're doing and how we are effectively changing the world through that. In Ohio Ministry Network, our partnership with them provides resources and training for Southeastern University of Ohio, so the next generation of ministers and missionaries and businessmen and women to create a culture, a gospel-centered culture for their academic degree. Church health classes, 300 plus PKs and MKs, so it's pastor kids and missionary kids on a retreat. And I want to share this with you. Pray for us, because in January we go to Kalahari for PK-MK retreat. Pastor Sarah and I have been invited to be the speakers to be able to minister to those 300 plus pastors, kids, and missionary kids. And here's our heart. Our heart is that PKs and MKs would know Jesus as their Savior before mommy and daddy's boss. And so let us pray for those PKs and MKs that are impacted through Minister's Retreat. Ohio for Jesus grants that put missionaries on the field. All ordained ministers' contribution to retirement accounts. And then partnership with Emerge Counseling Services, which is an opportunity to partner with gospel-centered counseling in our world. How many know that people, more than ever, are going to counselors? Yes. I mean, it's important to have a counselor that knows the Word of God. Yes. Ohio Church Multiplication, 288 AG churches in the state of Ohio, the highest net gain of churches in the country, church planning and church launch training. And then Heartland Conference and Retreat Center, which I love this, just in summer camps alone. So that was student camps and kids camps and starter camps, 800 plus salvations, rededications, 300 plus Holy Spirit baptisms, and 700 plus students called into ministry. When we support missions, we support life change. Can we give God praise for what He's doing? Which leads us to our last thing. Everybody say, I can pray.
I can pray.
I can give.
I can give.
I can go.
I can go.
All right. I can pray. I can give. I can go. Matthew 28, 19 through 20 says this, therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. Can I encourage you, go where God has called you and placed you. And that looks different for each and every one of us, but go where God has called you and placed you. That is the best place for you to be, because there's somebody there who needs the gospel, and He's put you there with your story at such a time as this, to reach that person. Make disciples. Example and teach others lifestyle Christianity by obeying the word, saved by Jesus and empowered by the Holy Spirit. If you are a follower of Jesus, you are called to lead others to follow Jesus. As your pastor, I don't want you following me, I want you following Jesus. Right? So as a follower of Jesus, I am a sheep, He is my shepherd. I've got good news, He's the good shepherd. And so my hope and my heart as your pastor is, as we're on this journey together, is that I'm not sitting here going, follow me, because I'm a sheep, right? He's the good shepherd. So my shepherding job is to say, hey, come on into the flock, welcome aboard, let's follow the shepherd. And let's do it together.
Thank you once again for joining us online for Clearview Church Online Service. We love you, and we hope that if you are in the southwest region of Cleveland, if you are in Medina, Lorain, or Cuyahoga County, we would love to see you in person Sunday mornings, 9 a.m., 10:30 a.m., to worship together, to meet the rest of the Clearview family. If you're online and you can't make it there, we just want to celebrate what God's doing in your life. So if you want to write us at clearview@clearviewchurch.net, and we would love to just partner with you in your journey with Jesus. We love you, and we're praying for you. Have an incredible week.